I love my Amiga 500. It's an iconic machine that sold millions of units and put the Amiga in the household of many, particularly in Europe. But it's not always been an easy machine to expand. A few years ago, the obsolete geek made a video called Pimpin the Amiga, where he expanded his A500 internally with 8 MB of fast RAM and added compact flash via a Kipper 2K expansion board. If you haven't seen it, link is in the description below. Now, my Amiga 500 contains the very excellent ACA 500 Plus side expansion, but I've always wanted to be able to expand my Amiga 500 internally, just like the obsolete geek has. But I wanted to include an accelerator card, compact flash, more RAM, and be able to close the case and have no side expansions. Now, in the past, this has been a particularly expensive proposition. Amiga 500 accelerators from back in the day are pretty scarce these days, and when they do show up, they are very expensive. Until now. Stephen Leary, also known as Terrible Fire, has designed a completely open source Amiga 500 accelerator called the TF530. My card is the second revision, and it features a 68030 accelerator clocked at 25 MHz, an IDE header to add a hard drive or compact flash device, and 2 MB of fast RAM. The TF530 can be built from parts if you know what you're doing, and there are many people out there that have already built their own from Steven's work, and the best part, it's very cheap. Now, I'm not skilled enough to solder on CPUs and small components onto a motherboard, but fortunately there's an active community out there who's willing to do that for you. For the low cost of $130, this board means I can finally pimp my Amiga. So, we're going to go ahead and install the Terrible Fire card into my Amiga 500. Now, this particular A500 has Kickstart 1.3, and I want to continue to use Kickstart 1.3 and boot off the compact flash device utilizing Kickstart 1.3. Now, normally this is a very tricky thing to do because the ability to boot off a hard drive was only available after Kickstart 2 and onwards. But there is a way to patch the SCSI device driver that the Amiga uses in its Kickstart ROMs into a 1.3 Kickstart. So let's go ahead and open the case. Now, I've done this a million times before, but in case you haven't, it's just 6 screws. They are either going to be Phillips or Torx screws, and if you have Torx screws, use a T9 bit if you want to open your case. Next, remove the keyboard connector. We can finally expose the motherboard. This is the Kickstart chip, as I mentioned, is the 1.3 chip, and what we are going to do is remove it from the motherboard in order to dump the ROM, and then patch it with the SCSI device driver. I remove the Motorola 68000 CPU. The reason for this is that this is where the Terrible Fire card will fit into. Incidentally, I use a small flathead screwdriver to remove chips almost all the time. Just gently lift both ends off until the chip comes right off. Be careful not to bend any pins, however. Finally, I have an Indivision ECS scan doubler in this machine. I'm going to remove this as well, as I don't really use it. I don't want any cables or expansions hanging off of my system, and there's no easy way to mount the VGA connector that it comes with. So to dump the Kickstart ROM, I picked up a cheap eeprom reader and writer, the GQ4X4. I put in the Kickstart chip from my Amiga 500 and dumped the contents to a file. Now, you might be wondering why I didn't just download a Kickstart 1.3 ROM from the internet. Well, I guess I could have done that, but I want to make sure that this is 100% original and not modified in any way. In order to patch Kickstart 1.3 with SCSI device, we use a tool that's available called Kick 1.3 SCSI Patch. The instructions are quite simple, and I won't bore you with the details in this video, but just follow through the guide and you will have a patched Kickstart image in no time. Now we can burn this image to an eeprom and then use that in our Amiga 500.
So for those people that are interested or might be interested in burning your own Kickstart ROMs and you're thinking about picking up an eeprom burner, I have a couple of pieces of advice for you. It's like getting a CD burner for the first time. You're going to make a lot of mistakes and burn a lot of coasters. In this case, you're going to burn some bad EEPROMs and you're going to have to erase them with an eraser, which usually takes anywhere from 15 to 30 minutes to erase those chips in order to try again. So you're going to make a lot of mistakes. The second thing that I really want to stress is make sure you have a dedicated machine to burn EEPROMs on. When I first got my EEPROM burner, I was actually trying to use the machine behind me, which is my dedicated gaming, video editing, kind of day-to-day machine that I use for pretty much everything. And I was getting a lot of burn errors midway through the burn, and I didn't really know why. And when I had read up on this, really the best thing you can do is use a dedicated machine, and it ended up being much better. So I ended up using an old Dell i3 laptop that's about 9 years old, and it has Windows 7 on it, a web browser, and this software, and I've had nothing but success with this particular piece of hardware. Now, if you are thinking about burning Kickstart ROMs, the third piece of advice I have is, now you want to use an AMD 27C400 chip, and you want them rated at 120 nanoseconds or faster. If you use a 150 or anything slower, the chances are the Kickstart ROM is not going to boot on your Amiga. Now, mileage may vary, of course, but I think the rule of thumb is anything that's 120 nanoseconds or faster will work on any spec Amiga there is out there.
Now we can burn this image to an EEPROM and then use that on our Amiga 500. In order to do this, we place one of the 27C400 chips into the burner and load the patched Kickstart ROM that we created. Now this part is important, and it's one step that many people forget. You must byte swap the image file. All EEPROM burning software should have this ability, and if you don't byte swap the ROM, it won't boot. After about a minute or so, our Kickstart is burned and ready to go. If you are burning EEPROMs, make sure that you put a sticker to cover the glass. UV light is used to erase these chips, and they can easily start to go bad if there's too much light exposed onto the glass. Now, I decide to test the Kickstart chip we burned by fitting in the 68000 CPU back into my Amiga 500 temporarily, and when we power it up, absolutely nothing happens. When I put the same Kickstart chip into my Amiga 600, that booted instantly, so I knew my Kickstart was good. It even booted to the compact flash card. So in order to make this Kickstart chip boot on my Amiga 500, we need to do some modifications that we're going to take a look at right now. Some of the earlier revisions of the Amiga 500 only supported a 256 kilobyte Kickstart image. I have a revision 5 motherboard, which is one of those revisions, unfortunately. However, there is a small modification that we can do to make this happen. Let's check it out.
So we're going to go ahead and do the revision 5 modification to the A500 motherboard. So what we need to do is essentially bridge a wire from pin 1 on the Kickstart ROM to pin 31. So what I'm actually going to do is actually flip the board over and do the modification on the other side of the board. And once we've done that, then we need to take this chip out, lift pin 31, and then bridge the connection from pin 21 to the lifted pin 31. And that should give us what we need.
We'll be right back. now we're going to fit the Kickstart ROM back into its socket. And fingers crossed, this should boot up to Kickstart 1.3. Now that we have our Kickstart ROM booting, it's time to fit the Terrible Fire accelerator back into the Amiga and button it up. I fitted a compact flash adapter to the card. Please note that this is a 40-pin IDE connector and requires its own plus 5 volts of power, so I pulled it from the floppy drive connector and built a splitter to share the power between the compact flash card and the floppy drive. Everything fits inside the case nicely, and I'm going to reattach the keyboard and power up the Amiga. Yep, everything looks good. Now let's button the machine up, and this project is completed. Let's check out the final result.
I wanted to give a big shout out to Terrible Fire, Stephen Leary, for producing the Terrible Fire cards. I'm going to leave a link in the description below of his YouTube channel. Go check it out. And the GitHub page where he's got all the information that you need to build your own Terrible Fire cards. I will also leave a link in the description below about where I bought the EEPROMs from and where I bought the eeprom burner from. So if you are interested in doing something similar yourself, you should have all the information that you need. So please check out the description below for all the links that you need in order to pimp out your own Amiga 500 just in the same way that I did. Well, that'll do it for this video, guys. Let me know what you thought about in the comments below. As always, don't forget to like and subscribe. I'll catch you guys in the next video. Bye for now.